Are we good to go?
Yeah, Narendra, you can carry on. So let me introduce you. Let me just, kick off. So guys, thank you very much for joining today. Another Impact Salesforce Saturday. This time we've got Narendra Singh. As you know, he's a Salesforce developer admin. He's also a Salesforce MVP. So congratulations for that, Narendra. And right now he's working out of Berlin, and he's a very distinguished Salesforce developer and community leader and contributor. We have seen him run some really beautiful programs last year. Again, Narendra would can talk about those programs at the end of the session. But yeah, thank you very much for joining in, guys. And Narendra, over to you. You can carry on.
All right. So, hi and welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us today for another session at Impact Sales for Saturday. I really wanted to do a session at New Delhi Salesforce Developer Group because this is the group where I started my Salesforce journey from. So, this group will always have a special place in my heart. And I thought, since the low-code love is so popular right now, so why not just ride the wave? And so I came up with this topic, and I'm very excited to talk about flows and how you can implement team-based sharing model using flows. So without any further delay, let's get started. So, all right, who am I? So I'm a Salesforce developer working at Sales5 Consulting here in Berlin, Germany. I'm also a Salesforce MVP. I'm also a part of Einstein's Champions Program. I am also a blogger at forcepanda.wordpress.com. These are my social media handles. Feel free to reach out if you want to have a conversation with me. I'll be more than happy to engage with you guys. Now, I'm going to briefly hand it over to Atul or Sagar, so they can introduce about the group and the Salesforce Impact
Sure.
Sales Saturday initiative.
Thank you, Narendra. Yes. So guys, I'll quickly a little brief about what the New Delhi Salesforce Developer Group does and what it's all about. So we've got multiple programs under our wing. So we've got Impact Salesforce Saturday. We have been doing our in-person Salesforce meetups. I hope in the next couple of months this whole thing kind of gets settled down with the COVID-19, and we can start with our in-person meetups very soon. You can follow us on our Twitter handle, New Delhi SFDC DUG, and you can also follow the hashtag Impact Salesforce Saturday to check all the things that are going on with Impact Salesforce Saturday. We have got so please become part of the Trailblazer community group, as well as subscribe to our website. So the community group and the website are the two places, and particularly the website where we share all the updates related to these programs. On the website, you can see an events calendar. On that calendar, you'll be able to see all the sessions that we have planned so far and all the sessions that we are planning. We're continuously adding. So most of the time, you're going to have a visibility of not more than 2 to 3 sessions in the future. And we keep on adding more sessions as time goes by. And for now, guys, frankly, from our point of view, we are packed till September and October. So you're going to be seeing one session every week till September, October. And our main emphasis is on series of sessions. So instead of doing, so it's an emphasis. Again, it's not like we are not going to do one-off sessions, but our emphasis is on the speakers who can come and they can do a series of sessions so that we can dive deeper into a topic instead of doing a one-hour session and then you're not listening or hearing about that session again. So we have, as part of those series, we have already done a Pardot series. We are going to be soon doing a couple of more series. You're going to know more about them. Just keep watching out. The best way to know about these things is our Twitter handle and our website. So go to our website and subscribe. And, as soon as a new post is going to be added, or new series, or new session is going to be added, you're going to get an email right in your inbox. Naindra, if you can go to the next slide. All right, there you go. Naindra, you can introduce. Yeah, Mentorship Central. Yes. So guys, another program that we have as part of the New Delhi group is the Mentorship Central. Again, some of you already know about this program. It's a program where mentors can find mentees and mentees can find mentors. This program is, So this program has been running for the last couple of years, and you know, Salesforce came out with a program which is quite similar to this. There are a number of differences. First, in this program, a mentee can choose the mentor. You know, you don't get a mentor or mentee assigned to you like out of the blue. You can choose who you want to be as a mentor, and the mentor can also choose whether they want you or someone as a mentee or not. They can either accept you, reject you. And let's say after a couple of months, you have run your course and that mentorship relationship, that relationship with that mentor or mentee doesn't make sense to you, you can just deactivate that relationship and move on with other mentors or mentees. So this has been going on. We've got hundreds of mentors active right now. And if you guys at any time got any issues related to finding a mentor or mentee, please don't hesitate in reaching out to us. We've got email ID mentioned over there. Awesome. And you can go and check out the whole platform at bit.ly SF Mentorship Central. Again, guys, make sure bit.ly links are case sensitive. Narendra, over to you.
All right. Just a bit of a, I think there is some construction work going on in my adjacent household. So,
Narendra, I think your voice is very clear. So you can carry on. You don't need to worry about it. We don't hear anything.
Thank God. Okay, so moving forward. So what do I have in store for you guys today? So how we are going to approach this session is, first we will set up some base context by understanding how sharing works in the Salesforce, on the Salesforce platform. And then we will briefly touch upon how the team-based sharing works. And then I'm going to introduce a use case, which is obviously going to be related to a sharing concept. And then we can dive into the demo of the same. All right, so what exactly do we understand by sharing in the context of Salesforce? Sharing is basically what the word means, and what happens in the sharing is we basically share the records inside the Salesforce with different users across the platform. So there are three types of sharing mainly in the on the platform. So first is managed sharing, then we have user managed sharing, and the third one is Apex managed sharing. So managed sharing basically is the sharing concept which is handled by the platform. For example, ownership, sharing rules, etc. And then user managed sharing is some also called manual sharing. So the concept of manual sharing, where you manually share the records with other users, falls under this category. And then you have this third category called Apex managed sharing, which basically allow developers to programmatically share the records via Apex. And then you have different access levels which you can give to your users with whom you are sharing the records. Full access is basically a permission, the access that is only provided by the platform, and you cannot provide this platform this access level when you are using any sharing method which is not running by the platform. So basically, if you are doing something out of managed sharing, you will not be able to provide this access because it's only given by the platform. All right. So what happens? What is exactly how the sharing model works for on the platform is that for every object in the Salesforce where you can implement record sharing, there is another standard object which comes complementary with the name of object's name, and it is appended by the word share. And this share object basically contains all the record sharing information, and we will see how it looks like in the upcoming slides. So for example, if you have an account object, you will find in your on the platform there will be another object called object share. And similarly, if you have a custom object, you will have the same share object associated with that particular object. So if the name of the custom object is candidate, then the name of the corresponding share object for the candidate object is going to be candidate underscore underscore share. So let's see what the share object really look like. Primarily, and the most important ones are these four fields. So access level, as you can already see, it grants you read and edit access. It sets the access level. And the parent ID is the ID of the record which is being shared. Row cause is again an attribute in the object to store the information, basically that how the record is being shared. Is it an owner? Is it being shared manually? Is it a team? Or is it shared by a rule? So that's how it distinguishes between the various kind of how the record is really being shared. And then the user or group ID is basically the ID of the user or account that is with whom the record is being shared. So what happens is every time you create a record, every time you share a record with another user in your Salesforce org, there will be an entry in the share object for that particular object whose records are being shared. And we will see a bit more in the demo how it works. So let's understand what is really a team-based sharing model. So out of the box, we have account team, opportunity team, and case teams, where the record owners can use teams to basically extend the sharing. Basically, they have the ability to share those records with other users by adding those users to an object which is associated with the custom objects. And the name of these objects are basically account team, opportunity team, case team, respectively for accounts, opportunities, and cases. So all you do is you add a user to your team and then set their access level, and those users will be able to access those records. But the question is, what about other objects and especially custom objects? So out of the box, the platform does not give you this functionality to share the records with the team, but it does give you the flexibility to have it implemented by your own. So let's see, let's try to solve this puzzle with a use case. So we have a young recruiting firm called Force Panda, and they have a newly built Salesforce org set up for them. And as their business is growing, they have a lot of applications flying in. And since it's a pretty new organization at the moment, so they do not have a really well-established organizational structure. So the end users are pretty much doing anything and everything that they find on their table or what is given to them. So basically what this leads to is the firm now has a Salesforce admin called Stacy, which is an awesome Salesforce admin at Force Panda. And now she's been tasked to figure out some way to share these applications as and when requested by the application owner with other users. And after a long Googling and scratching her head, understanding how sharing works, finally, she was able to come up with the solutions, and the answer to her solutions was flows. So let's see how she really did and what was the solution like. So time for a demo now. So I'm going to stop the presentation and we'll start with the scheme. So for the first and foremost thing is how you design your data models. So I'll have two objects. One object is basically the applications where all the application data is being stored. And then we have another object which is the review team member object. It basically is going to store all the users with whom the application record is going to be shared with. So just to give an idea how the team member object looks like, we have a field called access level, which is a pick list. We have an active field we will talk later about this maybe. And then we have a role, and then we have a field called team member, which is a lookup to the user. Now, what I would like to show you guys, one important thing when we are sharing the records with the help of flows, or basically you are sharing the records not by standard means, which are provided out of the box by the platform. You should always, there is a thing called Apex sharing reasons. And I have added one. So the field, if you remember, called row cause, we will be using the value team member in that particular reason. So this gives ability for the platform to understand how the record is being shared and what is the cause of basically sharing the record with another user. You cannot find the Apex sharing reason in the Lightning view. So you have to switch to Classic view in order to create a new Apex sharing reason. So now also let's look at the sharing settings of the organization. So the organization do not want to share the records for applications. They do not want to share it publicly, so they have kept the org-wide defaults for the application settings as private, and then they want to extend this sharing of records with a team-based sharing model. So that's the sharing setting for application object. Now just let's see. So I'll just leave this one for now. All right. So I have a dummy record with me, and we have a related list which has the review team members, and we will see that how it really works. So I also have a user which I have set up, and we will use that user to verify if they really have the access to the record. So, all right. So Master Shifu is another user in the forcepanda.org. And if you refresh the records, you can see that Shifu doesn't own any records, so they are not able to see any records. And that's how it should be with the private model. Now, first I'll demo how the implementation works, and then we will go into the setup, how we have really set up the flow for the whole solution. So now if we are to share this record with Master Shifu, and let's say the access is read, let's call him a manager and save. And if we go back to the logged in user for Master Shifu and refresh it, you will see that the record is automatically shared. And you can view the information, but if you try to edit the record, you will see that the user does not have enough sufficient privileges to edit the records. And the reason why I have an active check on this is, if let's say if you are not really good with code and you know that process builders and flows do not have a trigger point for after deletion or before deletion. So what you can do is you can simply have a checkbox to keep the track of users with whom you can share the record. So if you set this, if you mark this field as active, it will share the record with that user, but if you mark this field as inactive or uncheck this field, it will restrict the access to that record. So now I have marked it, I have unmarked it. And if we save this, you will see that there are no records again in the user, for this user. So how we have really set this up? It looks pretty neat. And the solution is pretty simple as well. So right now I have used a process builder, but after summer 20 release, you can do it straight away with flows. So we will see how the process builder looks like for this one. We'll also see how the flow looks like for this one. So we have a process on review team member object, which handles all the process orchestration. And just a bit of advice, when it comes to automation, it's always a good practice to have one process per object. So you have all the logic consolidated in one place, and it also helps you in deciding in what order these actions are being executed. All right, so what we have here is we have an object which fires when the record is created or edited. We have a process that is fired. And then we have a formula which looks something like this. So reevaluate sharing when a new review team member is added with their status as active, or when the access level is changed for an active team member, or when the active state of the review team member is changed. In all these three cases, we are going to reevaluate the sharing. Basically, what is going to happen is we will fire a flow which is going to handle all the business logic related to the sharing of records. Then we have a flow called share review record with review team member. And then there is a flow variable called var review team member record, which is of record type, and then we are just passing the current record in the context on which the process is running. Now let's take a look at the process itself. And this is pretty much it. how the process, the flow looks like. It's very simple. And what we are basically checking is we are seeing that if what is the value of the active checkbox field on that particular record that we have. And I can also show you that we have this flow variable record called value team member record, which, and you have to mark it as available for input in order to set the value of this variable from the process. If you uncheck this, then it will not be visible to the process and you will not be able to set the value for this variable when the flow is invoked. So we are basically checking if the value of active and active field, and then we are simply creating or deleting the records in the share object for the review for the application object that we have. And how it really looks like is we have a share application. So if you simply share application underscore share, and there you have your object. So we have defined the access level. So the access level is coming from a formula variable. We will quickly take a look at that in a moment. The parent ID is basically the record ID, which is being shared. And then the row cause, we have team member. And for the user group, it is being shared with the team member field, which you have on the review team member object. And let's quickly take a look at the formula variable. So basically, in the backend, the value for the access level pick list in the share object, it only has read and edit. So I have accordingly used a case function to create a formula variable for this. So if the value is read on the selected pick list of access level, here the value will be read. If it's read slash write, it will be edit. So that's how it pretty much looks like. But what I really want to show you is what happens really in the debug, not debug, but on the object level when you share the records. So we will open up our developer console. All right. So we are doing a simple query which gets all the entities in the application share object for our application record. So I'm simply copying this ID here. And if we execute this, we will get all the entries with whom this record is being shared. So right now it's being shared just with ForcePanda user, and the row cause, as you can see, is the owner of the record and has the access level as all. So if we now share this record using this review team member object setup that we have, let's make it read and write this time and save it. What you will notice, as we discussed, that object, the share object, has all those entries. So now you will see something new. A new entry is being created automatically for Master Shifu and the row cause is team member and the access level is edit. So this is what we are basically doing when we are in the flow. We are just creating an entry for this object. So once you do that, the record is automatically shared with this particular user. And let's say if we mark this user as inactive and save it, it will delete the entry from the share object. And if we rerun this query, we will see that there is only one result now because the share object is now deleted. So the record is no longer being shared with the master Shifu record user. And what I really want to mention here is that you may come up with a question that what if there is a user which can delete the records. So what I'm basically talking about is, what if someone really deletes it from here? So this is what you can do. You can remove the delete permission from the object level for all the users and make use of this active checkbox. And that is why the whole reason I have implemented this active check, in order to come up with this limitation where you cannot fire the process builder or flows on the record deletion. So that way you can come up or overcome this issue. And I believe that will be all for the demo from my side. And then I have some resources that you can guys go look into. We can share the slides later after the presentation is done. And thank you for being a patient audience. And I think we can open the floor for Q&A.
Thank you very much, Narendra. So Narendra, I think we've got only one question till now. And guys, feel free to post any more questions if you have, related to flow, related to sharing, related to Narendra, or anything that we're doing here at Sale at New Delhi. So Narendra, the question, let me recite the question to you. Do we need to somehow enable Apex sharing object in our org? I don't see it in setup.
Apex sharing object. There is no such thing called Apex sharing object. What you really have to do is you have to set up the Apex sharing reason in your org. You don't really have to do it, but you must provide a value for the row cause field for the share object. And it's a good practice to have a sensible reason. You can just provide some random value when you are creating this record. You can simply just, even this would work, but it doesn't make sense to put this value. So it's always good to use the Apex sharing reasons, because that's why they are built in this context. And what I also want to point out, that if you have an entry here, let's say you have already an entry which is sharing the record just with the read permission, and then you add another record with for the same user with extended permission to edit the record as well, it's going to just override the record and it's not going to create a new. Even if you are trying to create a new record, it will just update the existing entry and it will just update the access level for this entry. Yeah. And if you have any more questions. Okay, so we have a question from Varuna. If a user is inactivated, that is in the share table, do we need to remove the user from the share table? I guess it will be automatically. I've never really thought about it. That's a really good question, but from what I understand how the platform works, it will be automatically removed. Okay, it will not be removed from the share object, if I'm understanding this correctly. I tested this once. Maybe we can test it again after the presentation ends. And then we have a question from Rahul. You said that from summer 20, we won't be needing to use Process Builder to trigger flow. Can you please throw some light on this update? So if you are following the release notes for summer 20, you will see that for flows, there is this new thing where you can fire your flows on record update, on after record update. So you do not have to first create a process builder and then have that process builder invoking a flow. I hope I can find you this update. Flow triggers. So this is that particular update that I was talking about. So trigger a flow that performs actions after a record is saved. So currently in the previous release, Spring 20, the Salesforce released the ability to fire the records on before event, but now they are also supporting the after event for this, when the record is saved or updated. I do not see any more questions in the chat.
All right, guys. Again, we still have some time for some questions.
So, Narendra, one question, like if someone try to learn a flow from scratch, then do you suggest any trail mix to them?
All right. Yeah. So I think there is enough content on Trailhead. You can simply go to Trailhead and search for the trail mix for flow, and you will get enough working knowledge of how the flow works. But the thing is, you have to do a bit of practice to really get used to it, because flow is basically a translated version of Apex, a visual translation of Apex. So you need to have that logical ability to process the logic and come up with a solution. So the more you practice on it, the better your logical ability to solve these are resolved. We have another question in the chat which says, is there any other option without using inactive flag delete records in the share table? Let me just try to understand the question. All right. So I'm gonna repeat the question again here. So Varuna says or asks, is there any other option without using active flag delete records in the share table? So if you do not go with this approach, then you will probably have to use triggers, because you have to invoke some automation on a delete event. So the only you can go with the route of creating overriding this delete button with a Lightning component or a Visual Force page. You can also go down that road, but you have to then use a bit of code in order to resolve that problem. But this out of the this approach doesn't really make you code at all, and you can just get away with using the declarative stuff. I hope that answers your question.
All right, awesome. Thank you, Narendra. Thank you very much. So guys, if there are not any more questions, we are going to wrap this session up. Again, Narendra, if you can go back to the last slide.
Yes.
Sure. So guys, again, you can follow New Delhi Salesforce Developer Group at, so join us on our Trailblazer Community Group. You can start conversations on our Success Community Group as well. You can follow us on our Twitter handle. This is the hashtag Impact Salesforce Saturday is something where we post our updates. You can also join us or follow us on Facebook. And for all the content that we're posting, you can go to newdelhisfdcdug.com and you can find all the content there. We are continuously adding more content. Awesome. Great. So I think, Narendra, that's it. That's it. Thank you very much, Narendra, for joining us and giving us so much information about the flows and how the sharing works in that. Flows, Salesforce is continuously updating flows, coming out with new things. So it's, we are, the entire community is kind of doing catch up with Salesforce. Actually, we're doing catch up with Salesforce for the last couple of years itself. A lot of things have come out. And I remember 2015 when I left Accenture, I used to consider myself king because I knew Apex, I knew Visual Force, I knew everything. Now I'm back to novice level because things have totally changed in Salesforce ecosystem. So I think it's a very exciting time to be in Salesforce, and you guys are looking at Salesforce as ecosystem evolve. So it's a really exciting time. So I think the best thing you can do, guys, is learn, and learn. New things are coming out and the ecosystem is exploding like anything. And there's so much opportunity to be that is being created, and there's so much to be done still left in this ecosystem. And thank you, Narendra, for supporting all of us in doing that.
Yeah. Thank you for having me, guys. Always doing a talk on this group.
Thank you, Narendra. Thank you very much. All right, guys. So we'll let Narendra go have his breakfast. It's early in the morning there. Mm-hmm. And keep watch out. And within 24 hours, we are going to post the sessions video as well as the slides on SlideShare. You can find it both on the sessions post on our website. All right. Thank you very much, guys. You have a lovely day. Thank you, Narendra. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Narendra.
Thank you, Sushant. Thank you, Vishal. Bye.
Thanks. Bye, everyone.